Right. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So, Admiral sir, that is a hard session to follow. So I'm here to talk to you about what we can do to make our islands a much better place. Not just better places for us to visit, but also better places for the people who actually live on those islands. Now, the government of India has identified 1,382 offshore islands. Now, these islands hold immense unexploited potential for fostering growth, growth that can significantly contribute to our GDP. Not only will it be economic growth, but this will also be social growth, because if you're able to enrich islanders, it will automatically lead to improvement in their quality of living. Now, obviously, when we look at our islands, we have to take care of the biodiversity that surrounds the island, and we have to take a look at the national security implications of developing islands. Now, before I move any further onto the islands, let me first tell you this really, really crazy story, a story that seems to validate everything that's true about Murphy's Law, where no matter what one did, things just wouldn't go right. So there here, in that circle on the screen over there, is the island of Elephanta. It's right next to us over there. And it's nestled between the two ports of JNPT to the east and Bombay to the west. In the neighborhood of India's richest city, the island is also called Gharapuri, the city of caves. Many of you would know that it is home to a very famous UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's a reminder of a glorious past. Art historians claim that the caves in Elephanta date back to the 5th and the 8th century AD. The island has a population of about 1,400 people who are residents on the island, and it has a transitory population of about 4,000 tourists that arrive every day. Historically, the chief occupation of the inhabitants of Gharapuri used to be fishing and farming. Now, due to a sudden increase in the population of the rhesus macaque, the monkey, they started eating up their crops. And because the traffic in the channel in Navasheva Harbour was really, really high, so their fish stock started depleting. So the islanders could no longer farm and they could no longer fish. The only thing that they could do was make money out of tourism. But that was a little difficult, because this island between the two ports had no electricity. The island was powered by these three old, inefficient, smoke-belching diesel generators. Even as these generators created noise and air pollution, they only provided electricity for 3 hours every day. So come 8 o'clock in the evening, it was a stone age in Gharapuri. No tourists stayed back beyond 6 o'clock. There were no primary healthcare facilities. There was no sanitation, because you couldn't have flushing toilets. There was no power to pump water to your tanks. There was a school. That school had no power. So this island between our ports could not have a single terrestrial power line reach it because of those two rectangles that you see. That is the area where the ships would traverse, and so it was impossible to pull a power line. You couldn't take it above the ground, and you couldn't take it along the seabed, because somebody would drop an anchor on it. So what about solar power, some of you might ask? Well, the answer many thought would be solar power, and Elephanta Island was a perfect example of how good intentions can be hobbled by short-sighted planning. See, a solar panel's energy output is maximized when the panel is always facing the sun. Now, that means that the fixed panels that were in Elephanta, panels like those, were only facing in one particular part of the sky, and there was a limitation on how much power they could generate. What is even more embarrassing is what happened to some of the larger panels later on. They planted the panels and they forgot that trees could grow over them. So eventually all of those solar panels came under the shade. We spoke to some of the local villagers over there, and they said that even when the panels were operational, nobody was coming in to maintain the batteries, the repair was difficult, and this is a problem with solar power in island territories where trees grow like crazy. So this is the story of Gharapuri, a sad and depressing one, where you lie next to India's economic capital, and yet the quality of living on the island is abysmally poor. It is so poor that it compares with the most desperately backward lifestyles found in the poorest and the most remote villages of India. Now I'm going to pause with the Gharapuri story over here and let's get back to why we should focus on developing islands. Taking forward what Admiral Anup Singh said, India has an enormous EEZ. Now this EEZ is approximately, so I'll just repeat the figures, is 1.6 million square kilometers if you take the Lakshadweep and the Indian Peninsula into the consideration. And it adds another 650,000 square kilometers when you add in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And like Admiral Anup Singh mentioned, the EEZ is lying untapped. All we have to do is explore it, we have to use it. But I'm more interested in the second part of what these islands can do for us. And that is tourism. Now, tourism is the world's fastest growing global business. It is also the world's largest employer. One out of every 11 people in the world globally is employed in the tourism industry. It's an important source of foreign exchange, and it is really, really important for the social, economic, and environmental well-being of many of the countries. Now, ocean-related tourism can come in many forms. There can be dive tourism, maritime archaeology, beaches, surfing, cruises, ecotourism, recreational fishing. All kinds of things can come under island tourism. Now, sustainable tourism should be a very important part of the blue economy. It promotes conservation because nobody wants to go to a dirty beach. So you look after your biosphere over there. And it generates incomes for local communities, thereby alleviating poverty. Tourism also has the added benefit of maintaining, respecting, and taking care of local cultures. However, we should also remember that this sector is vulnerable to the impacts of climate change and the fluctuation in global economies. Now, that notwithstanding, the government of India took a step forward in the year 2017. It started a body called the Island Development Agency, or the IDA. The objective of the IDA was the holistic development of our islands, focusing on community-based tourism. Now, the job of this particular body was to come up with infrastructure projects, plan for things in Andaman and Nicobar, in Minicoy. They spoke about the modernization of the jetty at Kavarati, the augmentation of satellite bandwidth internet services. They spoke about upgradation of Diglipur Airport. They spoke about the upgradation of Minicoy Airport. And after some time had passed, they came up with 18 project studies in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, out of which 7 projects are ready as of now, which, you know, a private member can go to them and take it up and set up his resort in those particular spaces. Now, while the work done by the IDA is really, really impressive, I'm not sure it is enough. First of all, we are talking about 1,300 plus islands and they have 18 project reports. So this is not even a drop. Now, what is really required is a grassroots approach, something that must address the unique requirements of every island individually. Now, my personal experience with the development of islands says that while each island may be unique, there are a few issues which are common to most island territories of India, and we'll go over them one by one. The biggest problem, of course, is that of stalled economies. Islands struggle for scale. They're really small. So it is hard to shake their moribund economies into a growth trajectory. There are some issues, however, that we may be able to fix. First and foremost, you have to give them electricity. Now, the importance of electrical power cannot be overstated. What quality of life can you expect in this day and age if you do not have electricity? Islands are remote. Supplying them with fossil fuels or with wired power is hard and it is expensive. Yet we have to find a way. Now, it is hard to scale up solar power in the case of an island, but other technological innovations may be better bets. Perhaps windmills work better than solar power in this case. Now, offshore wind energy is becoming more common, especially in Europe, where a lot of European islands are powered by windmills. Types of marine energy extraction is still in its experimental stage. In fact, in Hawaii Electric is doing an experimental program with wave energies. So there is a potential for importing some of those technologies over here to power our islands. Then we have water scarcity. The quotation is water everywhere, not a drop to drink, which is true in case of islands, because most of them have maybe one or two wells, which are the source of fresh water, but everywhere else is just seawater. The answer for this, perhaps, what water managers are looking at is desalination. Now, desalination is a rapidly growing technology. In the last 5 years, the capacity of desalination plants has improved in efficiency by over 60%. More than 150 countries today have active operating desalination plants providing water to their island territories. While we invest in desalination, we must also look at conserving the existing sources of water and newer and doing simple things like rainwater harvesting, because most of these places are along the sea, so they receive a lot of rainfall. The next problem that these islands face is that of transport and logistics. Now, I have mentioned before that islands have problems of economies of scale. So they don't have a critical mass to be able to provide the services that would otherwise be provided in larger land masses. So being landlocked, like Admiral Anoop Singh mentioned, impedes growth. It is just as difficult to be isolated right in the middle of the ocean. So many of the problems faced by our small island in the middle of the sea are similar to the transportation challenges of remote landlocked places in the jungles of India. Now, waterways and airports are the only way you can reach a remote island, and we must focus on improving our waterways. At the same time, we must develop our economies in these islands as more self-sustaining than they would be otherwise. Now, for example, you could take the example of a small village in Maharashtra which is really good at making sardis, and it makes sardis and sardis alone. It can cater for its other requirements by importing the other goods it requires from, you know, neighboring villages. Now, imagine an island which is that super specialized. What would happen to the quality of life of its inhabitants if it was to get its lanes jammed by bad weather for a couple of days? So one of the things that we need to do is give greater economic self-reliance to each individual island. Their economies have to be shaped differently than the economies that are happening in dry land. As populations in island grows, the need for waste management has become acute. Now, we have to use new technologies to be able to ensure sustainable development of these islands. Now, in general, if you improve the waste management, you will also be able to encourage something called as blue carbon economy. Now, the carbon that is captured in oceans and coastal ecosystems is of a higher quality than that which is captured by tropical rainforests. In fact, blue carbon sinks can sequester up to 5 times more carbon than a tropical rainforest. So in the fight against climate change, focusing on our island territories would be a huge asset for our country. All of this sounds difficult, and so I would like to take you back a couple of years to Lord Kelvin, who was the president of the Royal Society, the foremost leading scientific organization of its time, after whom the temperature scale has been named. He said with great confidence in 1895 that heavier than air flying machines are impossible, only to be proved wrong less than 8 years later. The point I'm making is that even though the problem of the islands might seem insurmountable, it's not that hard to do with a little bit of innovation, a little bit of technology. And I come back to Gharapuri. The problem of solving Gharapuri was to get around these two areas of traffic, which is what we did. A path was charted north of the areas of traffic. We decided that we will bury the cable 1.2 meters below the seafloor. This was the depth where it was calculated that the anchors wouldn't touch and fishing grapnels wouldn't drag. It needed a specialized type of vessel, a cable laying vessel. That's the kind of a cable laying vessel it requires. These are really, really expensive ships. Now, even if you could actually go out and hire one of these, you wouldn't be able to operate this in Panvel Creek because there is no depth. So we had to come up with an indigenous solution to this problem. And so we designed a cable laying plow, which will work in shallower waters. And this was it. This is India's first cable laying plow, which was used by fitting it on a barge rather than on a boat. We were able to use a tug to pull the barge which carried the cable, which carried the plow, which laid the cable, and then backfilled it as we dragged it along. And in doing so, we were able to give Gharapuri, or Elephant Island, power for the first time in 71 years since independence. And look what's happened since. The island has transformed. A place where there would be no tourists after 6 o'clock now has Airbnbs. A place where people would, you know, have to clamber onto crowded ferries now have Uber water boats, water taxis that take you there. So the point I'm trying to make is that where there is a will, there will be a way. We don't have to be overawed by the number of things that are going on. If we are prepared to pay the bill that is required, then we will... Actually, I screwed that up. So there will also be a bill. If you have to do something innovative, there will also be there will be a bill, and we have to be prepared to pay that. As long as somebody is willing, we will be able to develop our island territories. That's all. Thank you very much. If there